Welcome to the sixth video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. Today we'll be talking about the second chapter of the book, where we introduce advanced ideas with spin, covering topics such as the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen experiment, particularly the Bohm variant of that. You might recall that the Bell experiment was recently awarded a Nobel Prize. Not to Bell, because he had died, but to the experimentalists who first examined testing the Bell inequalities. So the second chapter is Advanced Quantum Mechanics of Spin. And one of the concepts that we introduce, built off of the Sterngerlock analyzer that separates the atoms according to their spin, is the Sterngerlock analyzer loop, which rejoins them after they've been separated. So it seems like this might do nothing, but because you can do something when they're separated, here I've illustrated for you what can happen if you have pass-through detectors that will detect the atoms as they pass through either of the arms in the analyzer loop. And you can do lots of interesting experiments when you add this device into the toolbox that you have to create interesting experiments with spin and the Sterngerlock analyzer. This analyzer loop, which is also sometimes called a quantum eraser, is quite controversial. It's controversial because there was a series of papers that were written that said you could never build it. And indeed, this has never been built to work with conventional atoms in a conventional Sterngerlock apparatus. But it has been built with cold atoms in a trap, and there have been lots of interesting experiments. In fact, a whole field of atom interferometry has been created by working with these kinds of analyzer loops. So now in the second quantum revolution, we can actually make and work with and use these devices. The Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen experiment was a controversial experiment. It described how quantum mechanics was incomplete. In fact, Podolsky went to the New York Times and gave them a story at about the time when the paper was released. Einstein was furious with this. He did not think that science should be decided in the popular press, and apparently he never spoke with Podolsky again because of what Podolsky did in talking to the New York Times. There was a proof by von Neumann in his book that essentially said hidden variables can't occur. They can't be used in quantum mechanics. That proof had an error in it. But John Bell came up with arguments to test the ideas of the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen experiment. And these have been tested since the early 1980s. The Bell experiments have completely verified that quantum mechanics behaves in this particular fashion. In addition, in this chapter, we talk about applications such as nuclear magnetic resonance. You can see an MRI machine on the left panel, and the experimental data on the right panel is actually one of the first nuclear magnetic resonance images ever taken. It is looking at the spectra of paraffin. All right, let's go ahead and browse through the chapter. You can see that I am starting off each chapter with a quote. The quotes are from non-scientists for every chapter except for one. The last chapter, I start with a quote from a scientist, but all the others are from people who are celebrities or artists or other creative people. And what we start off with is a discussion of the analyzer loop. You can see here the pictures where we're separating the path and rejoining them, and there's lots of details to understand about how the analyzer loop itself can work. And we have lots of illustrations that help you understand and follow the arguments that we're giving about the analyzer loops. Of course, part of the interesting things are when you start working with things such as detectors that work some of the time, or when you have detectors just on one of the arms versus two of the arms, there's lots of interesting issues about whether you have which way information or you don't. This, of course, all is related to complementarity, and Niels Bohr is the person who came up with the idea for complementarity, so we feature him in this section of the chapter. And Wheeler is the person who proposed delayed choice experiments, which play a prominent role in many of these more advanced experiments, so we have a lot of discussion about that. You can do delayed choice experiments with the Sterngerlock analyzer. When you add these kinds of elements into the analyzer loop, these are the exciter, which excites the atom to a higher energy state, the de-exciter, which coaxes the atom in the higher energy state into the low energy state, and a superpositioner, which goes halfway between exciting and de-exciting. And so there's lots of interesting things you can do with that when you have those extra elements that you add into your device. There are lots of questions about observer effects and so forth that we discussed. Then we get into the Einstein, Podolski, Rosen, and Bell experiments. Here are our three initial characters who discussed how quantum mechanics might be incomplete. And then we get into Bell, and Bell will tell us about how we can actually test these ideas. Now, the way in which I do the Bell experiment is not to actually work directly with the Bell inequality. We work with this remarkable idea from Daniel Steyer about a rotating Stern-Gerlach experiment, and then we just carefully analyze that, and then from that we can verify the Bell inequalities by the predictions that we have for what is going to happen in these different experiments with the rotating Stern-Gerlach analyzers. So the Bell experiments form a really advanced topic that we're covering here, but you don't really need very much advanced ideas from quantum mechanics to get there. And then we have this nice application of nuclear magnetic resonance and imaging. Nuclear magnetic resonance itself is also a fairly complicated experiment. It involves changing the orientation of the spin from up to down and then back from down to up, depending upon how long you apply a perpendicular magnetic field. It's used in chemistry to get fingerprints of molecules. And of course, it's used in imaging as a way to have non-invasive testing of many different kinds of diseases and disorders. I unfortunately suffer from some back problems, so I had a full suite of MRIs of my spine just recently in this past year. And many of you might not know that the MRI machine was initially called a nuclear magnetic resonance imaging, and then they dropped nuclear because they thought patients would be scared about going inside a machine that has nuclear in it. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.